The feeding system here is progressive, starting with 4 liters of milk daily in 2 feedings. This shed houses around 50 animals. What we are doing is managing a control board with several indices. Well, Jesse, here we have all the storage for the concentrates. At one point we were talking, and I explained that there would be 3 economic units. One is milk production, the dairy farm. Another is the agricultural side. And a 3rd economic unit is the industrialization of milk.
Where do the animals go from here? How does it work?
Well, as we just showed, this is the prepartum shed. Once the worker notices that the cow is uncomfortable and close to calving, he brings her here to the calving pen. This is the pen where all calving work is done. Once the calf is delivered from this pen, it is taken directly to the calf shed, where all health procedures and colostrum administration for the calf are carried out. This would be the calf shed. Here, the calf from the moment of birth remains in the shed for 6 weeks for males and 7 weeks for females. The feeding system here is progressive, starting with 4 liters of milk daily in 2 feedings, gradually increasing to 8 liters. The male calf leaves the shed at 6 weeks, while the female stays 1 week longer than the male. In the case of the female, once she reaches 8 liters, her milk intake is reduced to 4 liters until she is weaned and then moved to a group rearing system, known as the school, for about 15 days, which is already outside the shed. This shed houses around 50 animals. Besides liquid feeding, the calves consume a highly digestible starter feed until the 3rd week, after which they switch to regular starter feed.
Are you the one who prepares the solid feed?
Solid feeding in this shed consists only of concentrates. As for managing each cage, the floor is made of wheat straw, which is replaced once the calf leaves each cage.
Diego, after the calf shed, do they come here? What is this place?
As I mentioned, the male calves stay in the shed for 6 weeks and the females for 7 weeks. Once they leave the shed, they move to the school section for about 15 days and then to their respective pens. The males go directly to a fattening pen where self-feeding silos are used and a mixture of whole corn and a protein concentrate is prepared in a ratio of approximately 60% corn and 40% concentrate. The females, once they leave the school pen, follow the same system and are fed the same diet. When they reach about 160 to 180 kilograms, they are moved to the rearing pen 3. In rearing pen 3, what kind of feeding are we managing? In rearing pen 3, we are using all the feed leftovers that accumulate daily in the shed. We work with an approximate 8% feed refusal, and all the feed left over from the TMR, total mixed ration, of the lactating cows is mixed with corn silage to feed all the animals in rearing pen 3 until they reach the pre-breeding category. This would be rearing pen 3 and pre-breeding. We conduct a periodic analysis of the TMR leftovers to formulate the diet for these animals. From rearing pen 3, they move to the pre-breeding pen with the same diet. In the pre-breeding pen, once the animal is around 13 to 14 months old, it is bred, and once confirmed pregnant, it moves to the pen for pregnant heifers. Well, here we are in what is the office of the milking parlor. What we are doing is managing a control board with several indices: reproductive index, transition pathology index, rearing mortality index, and productive indices. We have 2 control boards. One, the one on my left, is from last year, and this one is from the current year. Here we are with Helio. Helio is the veterinarian in charge of the establishment. He is responsible for all the health aspects and all the treatment management and everything. Tell us a little bit, Helio, what are we handling here?
On the board, what is recorded monthly includes all reproductive indices, everything that is projected, which is calculated at the end of each month. Then we have the section on transition pathologies, including ketosis, mastitis, retained placenta, downer cows, and their respective mortality rates, both in cows, rearing, in the calf shed, and during calving. We also record the number of milking cows that pass through on the day of milk control. These are the total liters and their respective averages in the different groups, including the two main groups and the fresh cow group. Additionally, we keep track of the average per cow, so to speak.
Of course, the overall average, let's say, of the entire dairy farm, each herd with its respective average and the general average of the entire dairy farm.
In terms of parameters, what is in black is acceptable, and what is in red is an alarm indicating that we are exceeding the limits we accept on the farm.
Exactly. Each item, for example, mortality or percentage of ketosis, mastitis, each indicator has its target number. And once it exceeds that target value, it is marked in red, signaling the need to pay attention and take corrective measures to reverse the situation.
Yes, basically, we analyze what happened during the month and work on improving it for the next month in terms of the monthly review. As for the annual data on the board to the left, we use that to make corrections for the following year.
Folks, we are now in the kitchen of this farm, and Diego is going to show us the ingredients they have here.
Well, Jesse, here we have all the storage for the concentrates. Basically, we are using ground corn, soybean expeller, cottonseed, and a protected soybean meal with high bypass protein content, which we are using for fresh cows and high-producing cows. What we have here is soybean expeller, a byproduct, so to speak, of soybean oil milling and extraction. It is a protein product containing around 42% protein and about 7 to 8% ether extract. On the side here, we have the protected soybean meal. This is a soybean meal treated to make the protein more digestible in the intestine and less in the rumen. On the other hand, we have cottonseed. This farm, like the other establishment, is characterized by not only producing milk, but also processing it. It has its own industry that processes the milk. So they are aiming to maintain high fat and protein content. This dairy farm is currently producing around 39 to 40 liters per cow with average values of around 4 to 4.1% fat and 3.6% protein. We also have ground corn, which is a widely used input here in Argentina, and there's not much more to say about it. Another characteristic of this dairy farm, due to its high production, is that we are making a significant contribution of minerals and vitamins. We are working with an amino acid balance using protected lysine and methionine. We are also using the same premix for all categories, which contains all the minerals, and 100% of the minerals we use are organic minerals.
Well, Diego, what is produced here on the farm?
Well, here at this establishment, all the forage used in most of the rations is produced on site. The only things we are purchasing are protein concentrates and, of course, all the mineral mixes. Within the establishment, we produce all the corn silage used for the lactating cows. Sorghum silage is used exclusively for the dry cows, prepartum cows, and pregnant heifers. For the heifers, we use all the leftover feed and corn silage. Additionally, if the winter weather conditions are favorable regarding precipitation, which is the most limiting factor in this area, we produce winter pastures, especially oats. Oat silage is also produced and used for most categories. Today, we are also using it for lactating cows and in the dry and prepartum cow categories. My name is Diego Bertea, and I am an advisor in animal nutrition for several establishments in the dairy basin of the province of Córdoba. I am currently taking the different chapters of the course being taught by Dr. Mike. I find it quite interesting and above all very practical. I like it because it combines the management of the theoretical aspects with a bit of the practical side and the day-to-day management of an intensive dairy production establishment.
Now, everyone, let's understand a bit about how the farm operates, how many hectares it has, and what their plans are for the future. Here with us is the farm owner, his brother, and Diego. So let's start. How many hectares does the farm have?
The owned land here is around 200 hectares. Then we rent about 400 more hectares adjacent to the dairy circle. All of this is used for feeding the dairy herd, chopping, and ensiling. Of this, about 200 hectares are planted with corn, around 140 to 163 hectares with oats, which are rotated with first and second crop corn. We have 4 months of corn harvesting. Then we have 60 hectares of alfalfa, which is usually cut about 6 times a year, producing 6 crops. After that, we also plant about 40 or 50 hectares of sorghum, chopped sorghum, which we use mainly for the heifers, dry cows, and all non-lactating animals. As for the soybean expeller, corn grain, cottonseed, and amygma, I'm not sure if you explained what amygma is. All of that is purchased externally. My brother's company handles all the planting and harvesting of grains, and, well, the dairy farm, Raul's company, buys the grains from the other company, but the dairy farm must purchase them. What we do here is just chopping. We don't do anything with the grass, so to speak.
At one point, we were talking, and I explained that there would be 3 economic units. One is milk production, the dairy farm. Another is the agricultural side. And a 3rd economic unit is the industrialization of milk, where they process their own milk in addition to buying milk from another factory from 2 dairy farms.
And, well, we also market to other provinces. Most of it goes to the south of Argentina, to the provinces of San Juan and Mendoza, which is where most of our products are sent. How did it start? It started with my father and very few animals, particularly 2. As the story goes, it was 2. And, well, from there we started. It grew to 1,500 to 1,800 liters about 20 years ago. Then we, the sons, began working. I'm the oldest, then there's Matias, the middle one, and Nicholas, the youngest. And when we started, we began to see things differently. My father's approach was more pastoral, more free range, a relaxed, simpler system. And, well, we began to intensify, confining the animals, improving the feed with a nutritionist balancing the diet, having someone work as a full-time veterinarian here, continuously monitoring the diseases and all the animals. And, well, as of today, we have 400 milking cows with a projection of 600. It's true that if everything is in order, if the weather cooperates, last year the weather was tough on us. If everything is in order, by the end of next year, we should have 600 cows with the entire production line set up. The dairy farm has been around for approximately 40 to 45 years, but it's been about 20 years since we started working harder, more intensely, about 15 years ago. We grew from 1,800 liters to 15,000, almost 16,000 liters.
In addition to the projected growth in milking, there are other infrastructure projects planned to accompany the growth.
We plan to continue with the entire system of sheds and compost beds as we have now, so the 600 cows will have the same setup. Today, all the prepartum cows, fresh cows, are already under sheds. The calf shed, which I believe you've seen, is also under a shed, but we need to expand it because it's already somewhat small. We need to double its size. And then, what's next? What I want to do next is to create something like a compost barn, but for all the young calves. All the calves that come out of the calf shed will have a semi-enclosed shed to protect them from the weather. because we've noticed that when they leave the shed and are out in the open, we have some health issues. We want to reduce that.
Folks, we are wrapping up our visit to Don Hector's farm here in Argentina. I hope you enjoyed it. Subscribe to our channel, like this video, and see you next time.